Yeah, thinking about the government. I've been doing that for about 16 years now. Late last May, I returned home from Oakland, California, where I'd done work for the Judy Berry versus FBI trial and had put my name daily on media releases exposing FBI misdeeds and had stared daily into their faces as they lied to protect an almost assassin, but more than that, lied to hide the fact that investigation is really a small part of their work and they might choose not to do it if they don't want. Their main work, it seems, is sowing fear, dissension, and distrust and disrupting the legal activities of groups for social change. Ever since then, I've been thinking about how to live a healthy life and not succumb to fear. Unfortunately, to talk about government spooks, about FBI infiltrators, seems to border on the taboo among the radical activist crowd of Tucson Earth First, which is the crowd in which all my experiences and thoughts of spooks have evolved. The reason for this practical taboo? Well, the subject makes people worry about each other, especially since some FBI agents and informers feign concern over their own agency to direct suspicion away from themselves and onto others, and so the whole subject gets convoluted and creepy. To ignore the subject, though, puts in very real danger those who are unaware or less aware than they think they are. For instance, five Arizonans were framed and arrested by the FBI back in 1989 and went to prison, and might not have if they'd given more credence to the possibility of spooks who'd love to set them up. So, denial is dangerous. But fear doesn't serve any practical purpose except to wake you up if that's what you need. But no one needs to sustain a sense of fear. The question is, what action or attitude is appropriate when spooky people seem to be dancing in the shadows of your life? So, on this All Hallows' Eve, also called Samhain, it seems worthy to think about how ancient people dealt with the concept of the shadow. In autumn, and especially on this night when the veils between the worlds was considered the thinnest, they thought it best to look square in the face of darkness and acknowledge it, refuse to leave those spirits in secret, and instead drag them out of their hiding, dance with them, and if possible, bring them into the light. This, I believe, is a useful metaphor for how we might deal with the FBI. And so, All Hallows Eve, I'd like to shine a little light by telling my story of 16 years of experiences with the spooky people who call themselves the FBI. Now, my story is not unique. Similar stories could probably be told by dozens of other activists in Tucson, in labor, political, civil rights, animal rights, and other activist groups. Anyone working for any cause that the people in power find threatening can be targeted for dirty tricks and repression. Back in 1986, I strolled up to my very first Earth First campfire and found a heated discussion about whether it was okay to harass folks that were suspected of being spies. Two young, very brash men were confident they could tell who was a spy by their clothing and behavior and wanted to drive a particular man away. It turned out the man they'd pegged was a spy. An older, more careful woman, a leader at the time, said no, even if he was a spy, rude treatment served no purpose. She explained that we couldn't tell for sure who the spies were and might inadvertently drive potential activists away. The spies, she explained, could be thwarted by simply not ever participating in discussions about illegal acts if you were among the very few who engaged in those activities. So, my very first evening with Earth First, I determined never to ask anyone about anything that might verge on illegal subjects. Later, when I learned the FBI is also interested in personal information with which they create psychological profiles to help them better lie about, manipulate, and entrap activists, I determined never to ask anyone even personal stuff, which was an unfortunate and isolating decision, but seemed necessary if the FBI was doing what they were doing. Now, I wasn't immediately comfortable with the idea that some folks were engaging in illegal acts, but I decided I could associate with the group when I understood that about 99% of Earth First's work was out in the open, and the small amount of what was called night work was compared to the Boston Tea Party. I went home and told my kids their children would read about Earth First heroes one day in their school textbooks. And within a year, I was writing press releases for Tucson Earth First and hosting potluck meetings in my home. Soon another activist began using my dining room for his office, mostly making phone calls and drafting letters, and I assisted. Then one day we realized that clicks were sounding regularly over the telephone line within seconds of the beginning of every call. Over the months, I hated that my whole family had lost the right to private phone calls from our own home, but there was nothing to do about it. So the other activists and I joked about it and sometimes spouted monologues for the agent's benefit about our civil rights and our American freedom to dissent.
maggot called Fleetfoot, face full of black soot, talking at the heat, put plants in the bed, but the phone's tapped anyway. Maggie says the minute, say they must bust an early man, orders from the DA.
The must bust in early May. Well, it was late May in 1989 that the Arizona Five were busted. Dave Foreman, de facto leader of Earth First, shared parts of his FBI file with some of us, and I still have copies of 38 pages with references to myself, my husband, and my children, recounting totally legal work like calling other activists to a potluck, but often worded to invoke the idea of something nefarious going on. Any rational person might do what I did. I asked myself, was Earth First really the right group for me to associate with? I concluded once again that it was, because it seemed to be the only group I knew of that told the truth about politics and corporate destruction, so I would stay with the work. But I didn't want to just continue the way I had. I wanted to be a better activist. There was an organizer in Northern California who set an example I thought I could learn from. Her name was Judy Berry, and she had brought together environmentalists and timber workers, helping them all to see their common concern. Sustainable forests meant sustainable jobs and healthy communities. The bridges she was building, I fully believed, would help change the history of forest management in America dramatically in our lifetime. I wanted my work to be as effective as hers, and I vowed that, even though I was rather burned out right then, my kids were adolescents and my marriage was stressful, I was going to watch Judy, learn from her, and when my kids were on their own, I'd be ready to duplicate Judy's approach here in Arizona. But not long after I decided to make her my role model, Judy was the victim of a car bomb assassination attempt. The truly frightening thing, though, was that the FBI ignored all the death threats and other leads and arrested her while in emergency surgery and her friend Daryl Cherney and began slandering them within hours. They invented lies about the location of the bomb, lies that they tried to cover by shipping the bombed car to Washington, D.C., lies they either dropped within a few weeks or which would be disproven in court 12 years later, but lies that resulted in headlines around the world linking the nonviolent activists of Earth First with bombs and terrorism. There was no consolation, of course, in the fact that this was simply a repeat of what the FBI did to labor activists, Black Panthers, American Indian activists, and the student movement, and many other activists in decades past. But Americans have such ignorance of history, we're world famous for it, and so newspaper readers in America read the stories crafted by the FBI and believed them. It was as if a psychic bomb had gone off in my mind, and within a few years I dropped entirely out of activism. My last project for a long time was helping organize the 93 EF rendezvous on Mount Graham. There, the FBI mounted video cameras in the trees aimed directly at our greeting and information tent, and their helicopters chopped regularly overhead. That summer, by bad coincidence, an avalanche of personal crises hit. My son was diagnosed with cancer. Our health insurance company began sliding into bankruptcy, leaving me wondering how I'd pay for his treatment. My husband and I divorced, and other personal difficulties befell, and I entered a 9-year period of intense depression. First, I found myself unable to concentrate enough to keep my job. Never thinking that there might be some social safety net to help us, I applied to grad school to get my master's degree in writing so my kids and I could live on student loans while my classwork served as therapy. The therapy didn't work, though, and days came when classroom walls didn't stay perpendicular to the floor, and I saw the structures of my soul collapse. I needed to get away. So when my son's cancer was cured and my kids came of age and moved out on their own, I built a little straw bale house in the desert and became something of a hermit. In the year 2000, though, feeling stronger, I offered to organize a Judy Berry roadshow when it came through Tucson. I knew this would probably put me on the FBI radar again, but I wanted to do it anyway. Ever since I'd first heard about the German people remaining silent in the face of Hitler, I understood that each person who chooses not to speak their truth makes it that much harder for the next person. Someone else would have organized the roadshow, but I wanted to make sure that I didn't remain silenced, so I organized the roadshow. Resuming friendships with a few old EF friends, I asked about meetings and was told older activists didn't attend anymore because the vibes were bad. Someone confided that some people thought, and it always was someone else who'd been the first to say the words, but they had entertained the idea, that the bad vibes might be a symptom of FBI infiltration in Tucson again. One possible symptom was rude behavior having become acceptable so that new people and older activists naturally chose not to return, which meant the group remained small and cliquish. and the younger activists learned nothing from the older activists, the ones who knew the most firsthand about the FBI. Another possible symptom that worried people was the loss of media savvy and even legal smarts, so that peaceful demonstrations seemed to have a way of turning bad and attracting police and turning into what the media would call near riots. These intentions can be read about in FBI strategy papers. We older activists wondered, if our suspicions were true, which we hoped they weren't but still needed to be considered, what was our role? We weren't carrying the Earth First banner anymore, so did we have any right to advise new activists if they didn't ask for it? Was there a chance our experiences of over a decade ago had made us so paranoid we were inflating our worries? Well, the FBI's budget had increased, we'd heard, fourfold since the Arizona Five were arrested and Judy Berry was bombed, so they certainly had the manpower to keep a presence in our community. Tucson had long been of interest to the FBI, and now there was a small surge of new activists moving to town along with the Earth First Journal. Surely the FBI would have at least one undercover agent here. We asked the younger activists for a meeting to discuss our concerns, and for the first time in a long time, young and old packed a room together. But someone apparently talked to someone else before the meeting, gossip ensued, and accusations caught us by surprise. They wanted to know who was accusing who of being a spy. None of my fellow warriors wanted to answer that hot potato, so I did, and I've paid for that decision ever since. We were not making any accusations, I answered, but we hoped simply that the movement could practice some techniques for minimizing disruptions like rudeness and bullying. We did believe that the FBI was a concern, but weren't pointing the finger at anyone. We just thought the younger activists could protect themselves if they knew more about our experiences, if we'd be allowed to tell them, something that could easily take a weekend. To our relief, everyone agreed to plan a weekend in which older activists would share their experiences of the FBI that had never been passed on to the younger because of the emotional downtime that had happened after Judy's bombing. We would finally mend that rift, pass on our knowledge, and hopefully minimize these problems and strengthen the work. I was asked to help plan the meeting. But it never happened. Over the next couple weeks, a strange and disconcerting series of events occurred, including rudeness and accusations about accusations, and I'm sorry I wasn't a stronger person. I decided to step down from the committee, though I fully expected that the weekend of teaching would still happen, but it didn't. During the following weeks, someone began referring to my accusation, which they said could indicate that I might be an FBI provocateur, since what was now being called an accusation had caused a rift. This putting the cloak of suspicion on someone is a common FBI technique called jacketing. Of course, the person who said that about me could also be the provocateur. And so the whole question of who is a true source of division becomes muddy, and more so with each retelling, until everybody wishes the subject would go away. And so the taboo against talking about FBI fear is reinforced, which serves their purpose neatly. When I tried to correct the gossip about me making an accusation, whatever I said seemed to come back on the grapevine turned around 180 degrees. While I knew full well that the FBI could cover for a murder attempt, I was still hurt and disoriented by the gossip. I retreated again to my desert home and decided that the young activists would just have to gain their own experience about the FBI. Over the next year, someone would occasionally call and sympathize with me and tell me that accusations were now being made against them because they had defended me. Someone was clearly keeping busy creating division. Whether it was the FBI or just typical bad behavior, we can only guess.
Look out, kid, don't matter what you did. Walk on your tiptoes, don't tie no bows. Better stay away from those that carry around a fire hose. Keep a clean nose, wash your clean clothes. You don't need a weatherman to know which way the wind blows.
Look out, kid. Astute radio listeners might well realize that my story here could be a fabrication. Good. Your reasonable doubt exemplifies the confusion induced when the FBI decides to watch and manipulate your activities, no matter that you think you operate entirely within the law. The FBI intends to produce paranoia. And their professionals have been at it for decades, studying psychology, creating personality profiles, and testing their theories about what makes groups fall apart. Of course, they bumble often in their arrogance, as they did in not covering their tracks better with Judy Berry, but they accomplish a lot of what they intend to, and what they intend is a confused social environment in which we're forced to work as we try to protect ecosystems, endangered species and workers, and try to prohibit generally the corporate plunder of the earth. Instead, we spend too much of our time dealing with the hurdles they throw constantly in our way, from the terror of prisons and bombs to the more subtly perverse distraction of not knowing who in the movement you can trust. After grieving for my lost community for a while, I decided to get into my solitude, accept my loneliness as a teacher, tried to write a memoir about all this, and waited for the community confusion to resolve. Then March of this year, 2 years after this local trouble began and 12 years after Judy's bombing, I got a call from Daryl Cherney in California, who'd been in the car with Judy when the bomb went off. He was carrying on the lawsuit since Judy's death from cancer and asked me to come to Oakland to do media relations for the trial, finally being heard. I paused only long enough to recognize the perfection of this. It had been the bombing that had knocked me out of activism 12 years previous, and now I had a chance to face the actual culprits and my fear. Every weekday during April and May, and many weekends besides, I lived and breathed FBI machinations and lies. I watched the men on the stand daily, sworn to tell the truth before God, testify that they had good reason to believe Judy, a mother of two young children, had placed the bomb, designed to throw shrapnel, in her own car with the safety switches off and ready to blow when she hit the brakes, because they said the bomb had been placed on the floor near the back seat where she would have seen it. And they continued to defend this crazy notion even when the car itself was brought into evidence with its back seat in near pristine condition for an older car and its back door looking fine and functioning perfectly, but with the driver's door ballooned out and her seat with a hole blown through the bottom of it. Many, many other lies were told, which the jury easily saw through, and for which they awarded Judy's estate and Daryl $4.4 million. But day after day, those agents paid to defend us from evildoers obviously sought to hide one. Almost every day, I put my name on a press release exposing their lies and sent them out around the world, wondering whether I'd experienced any personal repercussions. Trial over, home again, I continued to avoid most of the younger Earth Firsters, waiting to see if they'd ever tell me they no longer thought me unsafe. Sadly, though, I still thought some of them weren't safe, and it dispirited me so that the FBI could create this poisonous situation. It felt like cruel and unusual punishment, I often thought, and I've never been convicted, tried, or even charged with any crime. Though I know I'm guilty of thinking differently than some very conservative men, I think we should practice democracy, for instance, in our decisions about land, water, and air, rather than this corporate oligarchy that seems to run the show. But I don't want to live in resentment any more than fear. So how do we keep from sinking in the subterranean blues? Dylan's music works. But I've been trying to figure out an approach both rational and spiritual to this problem of fear. And serendipitously, with the Day of the Dead approaching, I recently ran across a passage by the Tucson writer Leslie Marmon Silko, author of Almanac of the Dead, an impressively fearless look at evil. The passage I ran across, though, is from her more hopeful novel, Ceremony, which opens with a passage by Thought Woman. "I will tell you something about stories," he said. "They aren't just entertainment. Don't be fooled. They are all we have, you see. All we have to fight off illness and death. You don't have anything if you don't have the stories. Their evil is mighty, but it can't stand up to our stories. So they try to destroy the stories, let the stories be confused or forgotten." And skipping ahead, "There is life here for the people and in the belly of this story." So here is my story. My only alternative to living in denial or fear. Celebrate Samhain tonight by lighting a candle, and tomorrow commit to telling your truth of your experience. Perhaps it's not the FBI, but an oppressive job, or lousy water from your tap. Whatever, speak out, and maintain our freedom to do so. Happy Halloween. Don't wanna be a bum, you better chew gum. The pump don't work 'cause the vandals took the handle.